Our first speaker today is Kasia Świrydowicz from the Pacific Northwest National Laboratory. Kasia will talk about low-synchronization Gram-Schmidt algorithms and Arnoldi-QR factorization. Please, Kasia, share your screen.
All right. Okay. No, not this one.
Is everything okay?
My Acrobat is behaving weird, so let me relaunch it.
I can see it.
Sorry for that. So, can I start?
Yeah, please.
So, hello, everyone. I first of all want to express my gratitude for inviting me here. It's a great pleasure to give this talk. And the title is Low Synchronization Gram-Schmidt Algorithms and Arnoldi-QR Factorization. And while I'm an author, I mean, I'm a presenter today, obviously, this talk is a result of collaboration with multiple people, especially Steve Thomas from National Renewable Energy Lab, where I did my postdoc, Julian Anjou and Daniel Bailich from UC Denver, and Erin Carson and Katrin Lund from Charles University in Prague. And this work, while I'm working in Pacific Northwest National Laboratory, this work has been completed when I was still a postdoc in a different US DOE laboratory in Golden, Colorado. And this research was a part of Exascale Computing Project, which is my funder in this case. And this is a project that aims to put a lot of codes on really big machines such as Summit. So to understand where I'm coming from, my background is kind of subspace solvers. So what we are trying to do here, we are solving AX equals B, where A is non-symmetric, large and sparse, and by n matrix, and X and B are vectors. This doesn't seem like a particularly big or hard to solve problem, but there are two caveats. First of all, in our case, N is really large. And by really large, I don't understand something that fits on a single laptop. So by really large, I understand something that goes up to 100 billion. And the other caveat is that actually comes from the first one is that we need to solve it in parallel. So we are using it, supercomputers with heterogeneous architectures such as CPUs and GPUs. And our solver of choice usually in such cases, at least in the case I was working on, was GMRS. And I was working on, when this work was done, I was working on wind applications, on wind simulations. So wind turbine simulations are a great source of really difficult linear systems. And when you think about putting cryo subspace solvers on the GPUs, they consist of several different operations. And a lot of these operations are, those are simple building blocks, and most of them are embarrassingly parallel, such as vector scaling could be parallel, or adding vectors is parallel, or matrix vector product only typically requires local communication. The problem is inner product, because every inner product you do requires parallel reduction. And by parallel reduction, I mean all the ranks or all the chunks that compute your pieces of your inner product, they have to communicate the result. The result has to be gathered and distributed. And this is very expensive on these large systems because it would require communication over the network. So in order to get the solver, to get GMRS really, really fast, you would need to eliminate or combine inner products. So to make sure that there is as little of them as possible. And in GMRS, all inner products happen during Arnoldi-QR factorization of this, when you build your Krylov subspace. And in GMRS, you have three choices. The most popular is the choice number two, which is modified Gram-Schmidt. It's a stable algorithm. However, if to add ith vector to the space, you need I inner products. And these inner products are dependent on each other, so you have to do them also in order, so you can't combine them. You can also do classical Gram-Schmidt, and this is done, for example, in PETC. There are two inner products. One of them is bulk, and by bulk, I understand inner product of multiple vectors with one vector. It's on GPUs, it's basically pretty cheap. But however, it's unstable. Or you can do it twice, which is the choice number three, which is classical Gram-Schmidt reiterated or iterated. You do three inner products total, and two of them are bulk, one of them is a norm. So you think about modified Gram-Schmidt. This is straight from, like, you would see it in the textbook. So you take your vector and you would be computing its inner product with all the vectors in the space, and you subtract a component of this vector with this multiplier here, and then you do it again and again. So if you have, say, five vectors, you would do four inner products here, and the fifth one would be right here to compute its norm. You normalize at the end. So Gram-Schmidt is a modified Gram-Schmidt is a projection that looks like this. So you project first the first vector in space, second vector, and so forth. And you can do it the other way around, but it's unstable. So you can put the first one here, last one here, but it would require, it would result in an unstable algorithm. So these operations, so let's look at Gram-Schmidt from a different perspective. So this is our modified Gram-Schmidt. So what we are doing here really is we are taking your vector. Let's keep the norm for now for simplicity. So what you are doing here is you're taking your AI and so you are subtracting Q1 with some multiplier, Q2 with some multiplier, and Qi minus one with some multiplier. So the first multiplier, the Y1, would be computed as take your AI and compute its inner product with Q1. The second one would be take your Q2 and compute an inner product with whatever you got from the previous step. So it's AI minus Y1 Q1. And the third one would be the same. So you would be the same in a sense of take the third vector and compute the inner product with whatever you got from the two previous steps. So now think about this, let's write the ones that have Q1 and A, Qs and A as Cs. So here we would have C. And the ones that have just Qs as Ls. So we would have C2 minus L21 times Y1 was the same as C1, so times C1, and so forth. So what we are really doing here is a triangular solve. So you can think about modified Gram-Schmidt is about triangular solve. So you would have a matrix that has ones on the diagonal, the Ls on the subdiagonals, and Ls are computed as QK transpose QM when Ks and Ms go through, from 1 to I minus 1. Here you have your Cs that are Qs times A, and you are solving for Ys. So this leads us to a form called inverse CWY form of MGS projection. So we write this, combine all these little projections into one big projection that has a triangular solve at the diagonal. And how do we approximate this quantity? So you can do a triangular solve, and this triangular, you wouldn't compute the inverse. What you would do is you would put this as your right-hand side and just solve. And this result first time appeared in Bjork 1967 in his lemma 5.1. However, it was kind of buried in the paper. It was never emphasized. And I think he didn't predict the importance of eliminating inner products as we know now because of the development of parallel computing. It was also in my paper with Steven and Julian and others. Or we can construct this thing explicitly and with no solve involved, and this is completely new result. In alternative, you can use something that is called CWI form without an inverse. And in this form, you construct this matrix recursively in a series of MATVEX, and this appears in paper of Björk, Page and Mallard, and also Jesse Barlow from 2019. And these two forms are actually equivalent. And this would be in our new publication. So this all this theory leads us to one synchronization modified Gram-Schmidt. So one synchronization per every vector added to the space. So we'll be computing a row of our matrix L. So this would be you take all your cues, multiply by each other, because you already have your previous cues from previous steps. You would be computing the right-hand side of your triangular solve. And because you have Q here and Q here, you can combine these operations into one operation. And when you think about it in terms of parallel computing, this is actually very, very good setup, because you would read these Qs here only once, and you would do two operations per every Q read, per every variable read. So this is good in terms of performance. If you are using multiple ranks, do a separate triangular solve on each rank. And when you GMRS is typically restarted, and this restart values due to the storage requirements are not that great. You maybe would go to 50 or to 100. So 50 or 550 or 100 by 100 triangular solve is not a big deal. And normalization can be postponed to the next iteration. So what you would do is, instead of doing another inner product, you would compute this, and then you would use QI times QI in iteration I plus one, you would use this as to normalize your previous vectors. I mean, this would require some adjustments, because you would need to adjust your matrix. You need to adjust your Hasenberg matrix. It can be applied also to Arnoldi-QR factorization. So in this case, this is a completely new result as well. This triangular part, this of triangular solve here, we can use I minus L, and this comes from Newman's theorem, and this is new result by Steve Thomas, Erin Carson, and Katrin Lund. And this all leads us to a empirical result show that it's stable, and we are still working on complete proof of stability, so that it's, I know it also theoretically. So this leads us to a GMRS that is one reduced, and by one reduced, I mean one reduced per every vector added to the space. You are only doing the reduction, which is inner product in step six, and everything else doesn't require reduction. And here in step 13, this is what is indicated in red, is what we are doing, the I inverse CWI approximation of our triangular solve. And because I worked a bunch of engineers, one people would ask me, well, does it work? Well, it does work. And what does it give us? Well, this is the result of a wind turbine simulation. And you can see here the black line is ideal linear scaling. And this is done with GMRS with our one sync approach. So when you look about scaling, this is the time per time step. So all other parts scale, you typically don't see this result, because GMRS would eventually stop scaling, or you would even see either it would flatten, or it would even go up. And here you see, especially the red line, which is on the CPU, it's basically going straight down, and the one on the GPU is not bad either, especially considering how Summit works, but this is a different topic. So what we got so far is one reduce reformulation of Gram-Schmidt that leads to a completely different version of GMRS that is scalable. Similar thing can be done on with classical Gram-Schmidt. So classical Gram-Schmidt is an algorithm that looks as following. So what we have here is we're doing inner product in bulk. So take your vector, multiply, then subtract. So subtract to do a bulk projection. Then you do it again, and there's a theorem that says that twice is always enough. So twice would give you cues that have orthogonality to machine epsilon. And if you do CGS1, you would skip steps 4 and 5, and obviously in step 7 you wouldn't have any R2. And this can be written as projection as well. So this, in this case, it's much easier. Its projection looks like this. CGS1 that is unstable and CGS2 that is stable. So you do your projection two times. So here the idea is the idea of making it one synchronization is a little different. So you can't always get what you want, but you can get what you need. So instead of so what you will be doing is iteration I only do the first projections, but not the second one. And you would be postponing everything else to the next iteration. So in the second projection, which is step 5 in our algorithm, norm evaluation and update to R would be postponed to the next step. And in the current step, you correct what you had from the previous iteration. So you would be correcting both the, you're doing the second projection, you would be correcting R, you would be correcting norm, you'll be computing the norm. And all the correction terms, the norm and the inner product, they can be computed in a single synchronization step, which is a great advantage of this. So it would compute one big inner product and be done with everything and apply some corrections to all the other terms in order to make sure that everything is as orthogonal as it should be. This idea is not new, the idea of postponing. It appeared in the paper of Hernandez and his collaborators from 2005 and 2007. However, Hernandez, idea of Hernandez is he doesn't do the correction. So the algorithm from this paper is unstable. However, by adding 4 lines of corrections, you get it back to a stability. And this can be applied with a little bit of more work to Arnoldi-QR factorization and can be used in GMRS. So this requires a little bit more work just because we have the corrections are not that straightforward, but it's doable. And this leads us to an algorithm that looks like this. So do you have a global synchronization here, the same one here. And everything else happens afterwards. It doesn't require synchronization. Here we have these corrections I talked about with Q and R. You need to divide stuff, I think, twice in places just because of the delayed corrections. So, and does this work? Well, so in this graph here, you see comparison. I did it on the random 2000 by 50 matrix, but I produce my matrices in such a way that I control their condition number. So I go from 1 to 10 to 1 to 10 to 16 log 10 scale on the bottom. So as you would expect, the line with a blue dots is CGS1. So you'd expect this, and what I'm plotting here is the loss of orthogonality. So the difference between Q transpose Q and identity, and I take a norm. So you'd expect this to go like this. You would also expect CGS2 to be kept to be on the basically machine epsilon level, and our CGS2 one sync also is on machine epsilon level. So the yellow and the green line they coincide. So you can ask here, well, where are we going with this? And did it be applied to other things, to other algorithms or to other methods? So Katrin and Erin generalizes this construction to block Krylov methods. And I'm working right now on using this one sync approach in cryo subspace recycling. So that's all I have. I hope this wasn't too long. Thank you for your attention. Are there any questions?
Thank you, Kasia. Jemima, do we have any questions on Zoom?
Not at the moment, no.
Okay, Minhong, do you have any question on YouTube?
Yes, there's a question from Catherine. What do you mean that CWY and ICWY are equivalent? All Gram-Schmidt methods are equivalent in exact arithmetic, but these methods are not equivalent in floating point. Thank you.
Well, they are equivalent in exact arithmetic, but I'm still working on seeing how they behave in finite precision arithmetics. I would say they would be equivalent, but this is still at works.
Okay. Okay, thank you. All right.